Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Gerald Ledon, and I'm a PhD researcher at the Faculty of Architecture in Louvain-la-Neuve, Belgium. Well, the intention of my intervention is to give a brief overview of what I believe to be the essence of housing artifacts. According to me, there is a number of anthropological invariants common to all men. Some of those exist spatially. This is the case, for instance, of dwelling. To me, to dwell is to organize oneself in order to relate to the other. A dwelling is therefore the spatial organization of this relation. According to Leroy Grand, dwelling responds to three human needs. The first one, it creates a technically efficient milieu. The second one, it establishes a framework for the social system. And the third one, it creates an order in the cosmos. Now, the very notion of dwelling can be understood, as we've seen the past few days, in two different ways. The first one is house, that is, the built artifact. The second one is home, that is, the ineffable qualities of the dwelling relationships. As we've seen with Leroy Beauvoir, the two sides of dwelling can emerge from technical, social, or cosmic reasons. Our prime hypothesis is the following. While dwelling can emerge from the three reasons exposed by Leroy Beauvoir, they form an indissoluble whole in dwelling. Therefore, all kinds of dwelling, whatever their origin might be, cosmic, technical, or social, permit the elaboration of the relationships between an individual and other individual. This will be our prime hypothesis, so we'll go from a social point of view of architecture. Yet, our ability as architects is to deal with artifacts. Our goal is to study housing artifacts in order to see how they can support dwelling. Keeping this goal in mind, we have defined the relational potentials as the specific qualities of an artifact to foster home values. In order to illustrate the relevance of relational potentials, we have focused on a particular case study, that is, isolated modernist housing in Brussels. Within Brussels, four main building typologies are met. The first one is individual row houses that form city blocks. The second one is individual houses that do not form city blocks. The third one being collective housing that do form city blocks. And then the last one being collective housing that do not form city blocks. This latest category being our specific case study. The first physical feature common to all typologies is the definition of an enclosure. Different forms of enclosures are encountered, depending on the housing typologies, as you can see here. Enclosure is important since it allows distinctiveness. It gives individuals the choice to either meet or avoid other individuals. Topologically speaking, with such a definition of enclosure, others can take different positions. They can be outside of the enclosure, they can be on the verge of the enclosure, or they can be inside the enclosure. The following examples will exemplify relational potentials on the basis of those positions. When the other is outside, two types of enclosures can be met. It can be either impermeable, we talk then of body walls, or it can be permeable, and we speak then of facades, architecturally speaking. Before advancing further, two specific features of our corpus must be enlightened. The first one is its collective nature. It disables any singular appearance that was possible within the individual housing, as you can see here. So we can go from a specific appearance to everyone that actually is à la même enceinte, to say it in French. And then the second feature of our corpus is its isotropic nature, since the posture of everybody regarding exteriority is identical within all housing positions. If we now look at the enclosure's thickness, various physical features are met. The first kind of facades that we meet are entirely glazed and plain. They provide no hideaway position, and very few individual markers are possible. A second range of facades display a genuine depth, allowing a better sense of concealment. In addition, window sills provide inhabitants with the opportunity to mark their own space. A further refinement in facade depth is found within access galleries. They provide an additional layer to the building envelope. Yet, their public character often disturbs the individual character of the housing units. Then, private outdoor spaces provide larger relational potential, both in the field of space marking as well as in deciding to hide or to expose oneself to the others. Two options are encountered, with either cantilevered balconies, as you can see here, or loggias that enable a better sense of hideaways. Another feature regarding the relation to an exterior other are outdoor spaces. They range, in the buildings I've studied, from none, as you can see here, to several. The relationship with the interior spaces gives them a specific character and therefore differential abilities to relate to others. In the case of single exterior spaces, they can relate to the kitchen, giving it a service character, so you can see here the kitchen and the exterior space, to the bedroom, giving it a more intimate character, the bedroom in here, or to the living room with a more public character. Eventually, sometimes single terraces span in front of various rooms, as you can see here. In those cases, the varied character of those interior spaces affect directly the activities that can be held and the way people are going to interact with other people within those spaces. Other examples yet display two exterior spaces with two very different characters, as you can see here, with an exterior space relating directly to the living room and one that relates directly to the kitchen, providing very different relational potentials. Eventually, some examples even thrive to achieve those various characters within a single exterior space, as you can see here, with a place where you can actually sit, have a table and have dinner, and here, a place that's more hidden from the views, where you can actually hang clothes and stuff like that. Now, when the other is on the verge of enclosure, we can focus on thresholds. That is, architecturally speaking, doors, window sills, or just sills. Once again, the collective nature of our corpus displays various thresholds. For the sake of this paper, we have focused on thresholds toward the private realms. In some cases, the thresholds, it's very hard to say for a French speaker, is rather blunt, with just a single door opening directly into the living room, as you can see here. So this is the public landing, and the entry door would open up directly into the living room. There is no sign of transition. In other examples, single door entrances are backed up by a transition space, as you can see here, before the living space. All other cases display a genuine vestibule with double door entrances. Yet, significant differences are met in the reception features. Indeed, sometimes the vestibule serves all the rooms and distinctions can only be made through the natural flow of circulation passing in front or avoiding the more private spaces. As you can see here, with the entry door here, if you want to go into the living room, you'll have to go in front of the sleeping room doors. While in this case, you can actually go straight to the living room without passing in front of the bedrooms. Eventually, a further refinement displays two hallways with public and a private one to ensure proper distinction of public and private rooms. Now, when the other is within the enclosure, we can focus on either spatial arrangements of the rooms or room dimensions. Again, for the sake of this paper, we have focused on spatial arrangements and more specifically on the relationships between public, semi-public and private spaces. In the first series of buildings, there is barely anything separating public rooms from most private ones. They're only separated by a single door, as you can see here. So this would mean people standing here in the living room and people here in a bedroom. If they want to go to the bathroom, they will have to go through the living room. So this means, for instance, if parents have friends over for dinner at night, a child that would stay here in the bedroom would have to go through the living room, meet his parents' friend, and go to the bathroom. Others, however, do not display doors, but well thought out transitional space, with space contractions in direct views to soften the transition between the two kinds of spaces. So this is what you can see here with the living room being here, but there's a staircase that divides the space between the bedrooms here on this side and the living room. So it's more, it's less blunt than in the previous example. The second series of building displays a shared entrance vestibule serving at the same time public and private spaces. And once again, distinctions can be made with an extra door that would actually split the more public hallway and the private one. And as we've seen before, a third category makes a clear spatial distinction between entrance vestibule and night hall. In this case, the night hall is usually accessed through the living room. A further refinement occurs in some cases when a change of level reinforces the buffer of the night hall. And it also recalls the relational features that you would find in the individual traditional Brussels house. Relational potentials have been enlightened within three positions. They can be summarized into a limited number, as we'll see later. We believe any housing solution can be reduced to this limited number of relational potentials. In return, those relational potentials foster the specific fundamental social dwelling operations. We can summarize those relational potentials into four categories. The first one being the distancing potential, that is, the definition of a physical limit. That's what I said with enclosure. Then, the second one would be the occupation potential, that is, the potential of an individual marking of space. The third one would be the orientation potential, that is, the potential of encountering or retreat. And the last one would be the representation potential, that is, the potential of a specific image. As I said, it allows specific operations regarding the others. With the distancing potential, it allows abstraction from the others. That means you can actually ignore the other. With the occupation potential, it allows appropriation of space. With orientation potential, it allows articulation with others. And with the representation potential, it allows a specific posture towards others. The study of house artifacts unveils the basic dwelling relational potentials. In return, it provides us with an understanding of the social interactions that are needed to create a sense of home. This helps understanding which features are essential and operative for a house to overcome its plain meaning of shelter and actually become dwelling. Thank you for your attention.
I'm a PhD student at Istanbul Technical University at Architecture Department. My presentation is about a housing project in Istanbul named Bosphorus City. At the beginning, I want to talk about some determinations related to the topic of the paper, discussing the state of encoding space with the images of culture on the example of Bosphorus City. In recent years, the image of history and culture has increased significantly as seen in many replica places which imitate the physical existence, the aesthetic values, social and cultural properties of the real place simulating it. Since the rapid development of material and building technologies has resulted in lessening of differentiation among the buildings from distinct sections, which have got various cultural values. Many spaces have been designed referring to historical and cultural images as a tool of characterization for the architectural concept. With the rise of phenomena such as historicism, there are appeared many thematic architectural models in order to create a distinction in design industry. Due to all these statements, the aim of the paper is to understand how encoding spaces with images of culture reflects to representational space. Bosor City, being one of the housing projects in Turkey, has applied to some cultural and historical references in the process of imagery and construction, so it has created an artificial world for their uses. Since architectural space is seen as a commodity or a tool of consuming, designers and producers have ornamented their designs with some representation tools, such as images, texts reflecting an ideal life script. Therefore, in the process of planning the research, it has benefited from a new method called script analysis that Madeleine Akrich and Bruno Latour have introduced to design history publications. The script analysis exemplified as an unconscious living plan will be used in reading the images and the rhetoric of architectural product. As well as Akrich and Latour, Mary Tubak, who part the script analysis method as physical and socio-technical script, has searched the relationships between products' material utility and socio-cultural utility. Thus, the method of script analysis can be a highly useful tool to understand how a product's physical and aesthetical expressions, social and cultural meanings are constructed in the context of architectural representation. According to Anastasia Hiller, architectural representation can be accepted as simulation that imitates the appearance or the character of object and adds that it must be considered for both its physical value, such as form, measure, scale, materiality, and its poetic nature, such as symbolism, sign, and meaning. In this respect, most architects have applied to representing tools, images, text, drawings, models, etc., when realizing their imaginations in a scene, where both physical expressions and sociocultural meanings are encoded into. The crucial point of the paper is that it has not only focused on the physical reality of architectural image, but also its encoded meaning built through symbolizations and interpretations of sociocultural parameters. Therefore, the study has started with the evolution of life scripts encoded on architectural space with the images of culture and history, with some rhetoric accompanying them during the inscription. Bosphorus City project, called the second Bosphorus of Istanbul, built in the Küçükçekmece district of Istanbul, consisting of one Bosphorus, two bridges, as well as waterside villas, interpreted with traditional and modern architecture with distinguished Bosphorus quarters of Istanbul city. Since developers and designers set out with such a strong claim that guarantees building the second Bosphorus with all its qualities, they normally applied to lots of images by architectural representation models and by some media press channels such as newspapers, introductory videos, commercials. The main purpose of all these images encoded a strong living script is convince public that the project is not an imagination, otherwise it is an alternative to real Bosphorus district. It can be said that developers and designers have described many different life scripts, differentiating in respect to the possibilities, choices, and socio-cultural parameters in the project. Especially based on the variable house options, there's lots of rhetoric accompanying the images on the architectural representation. And living Bosphorus. First secret related to the landscape concept of the project is built on the rhetoric of living Bosphorus. Reviving of Bosphorus landscape with such symbolization doesn't reflect the real existence of the image, since this sort of landscape planning is not a special one. It is a common organization seen everywhere, every planet area. The Bosphorus is even more beautiful from the hill. Looking from the seven hills of Istanbul to Bosphorus is symbolized with seven high towers. Looking from the it can be accepted that there is a strong connection between the rhetoric and the image of representation due to this abstraction. Pose of the Bosphorus. Thirsty Grip has written on the concept of seaside villas at Bosphorus City Project, consisting of some impressive images as well as a strong rhetoric escorting them. The Villa of Pashas. There's another simulation of space. It reflects Yeniköy seaside villa in Bosphorus City, saying there is only one from this kind of building. Nobility living in traditions. By the imagery of historical spaces, the villas are encoded with lots of signs and meaning of the real ones, assuming that every seaside villa in this project has got its own story. So the images of Third Secret are just a representation or symbolization of other content, such as physical similarity and the story of real ones. Are one side modern, the other traditional. To the rhetoric in seaside buildings, a rich life is designed by the figures of ancient Western Anatolia, Turkish planning and architectural rhythms of Istanbul. But it uses modern building technologies at the same time. Also, the images are encoded not only with houses, but also with piers, the water, the timber boats accompanying the scenario, which helps to create a pseudo atmosphere imitating real Bosphorus. Green Bosphorus and Magnificence. The magnificence of palaces in real Bosphorus is reflected representation with huge structures, symbolizing the monumental palaces of Bosphorus in Istanbul. And this script offers a life full of fun in the center of social life by decoding it with crowded people images. In addition to that, the images represented very illuminated and active, symbolized the shine of pearl emphasized in the rhetoric. Judas Trees, the lungs of Bosphorus City. Seven script is related to Judas Trees in Turkish, Erguvan. Houses which take its name from Judas Trees of Bosphorus in Istanbul. The rhetoric accompanying the images describe these houses as the lungs of Bosphorus City, like Judas Trees of real Bosphorus. In the representation, houses are pictured with a gabbard structure to take air easily into building and its surprising gardens. In short, when presenting the Bosphorus City, many scenarios are written defining which kind of lives waiting for users on the images, supporting with a strong rhetoric. Now, in the second part, we will develop a closer analysis to representation of Bosphorus City by the method of script analysis, which helps to understand how meaning both functional and symbolic is constructed through images and rhetoric. While reading the physical script of Bosphorus City, the representation images of the project has been analyzed according to Umberto Eco's theory, which is related to Kitsch works. Owing to the fact that Bosphorus City project claims to reinterpret the historical and cultural values of Bosphorus, Eco's description of Kitsch seems fairly useful to observe the physical secret of the Bosphorus City. The fake of Kitsch, described as false representation of the world by Eco, consists of some parameters, such as obvious lack of proportion, by something seems out of place, prefabrication, and imposition of an effect. In the presentation of bridge in Bosphorus City, the null component is reflected with its right proportion. Such as Bosphorus bridge, many components are reinterpreted according to new measures the project suggests. Although in reality the bridge is larger than other components of Bosphorus, its picture is smaller in the images. does the bridge which carries heavy car circulation, in fact, has transformed into a space where you can only walk on. It can be said that there is a conceptualizing of architecture realities with new approaches and new concepts that lead to appear a new perception and meaning of the space by reinterpretation. Also reflecting the bridge as a walking space on the representation is the same with indicating the Bosphorus as a river where you can sail in a small boat on the contrary to Riva. Since Bosphorus City is constructed in Küçükçekmece, that's situated out of historical peninsula, the place has got different environmental cause apart from actual Bosphorus area in Istanbul. However, some components not related to the location of Küçükçekmece, the project cited, are used as the representation tools by pictured Bosphorus City. In the images of Bosphorus City, many seagulls are placed, although they are peculiar to the space of seaside as Bosphorus location. The imitation of Bosphorus by encoding image with seagulls creates a pseudo-atmosphere for its users. So there appears a gap between what design images and objects actually do in the context of representation. There's another reference to Bosphorus daytime and cutting images with some people sitting at the side of Bosphorus, including boats, piers, etc. And the prefabrication, setting the Bosphorus in another place is the similar with building a city from the rough. Thus, many complex buildings such as waterside villas and bridges are built in a very easy prefabricated pathway. As Bosphorus City is the prefabricated version of Bosphorus location, which is very large and massive structure, in fact, it's pretending as a place can easily consume. Also, the rhetoric describes the project where the life is going on with full speed and reflects the notion of speed to the images. On the other hand, piers are constructed as a prototype of real ones in a prefabricated way. As the imitated Bosphorus has not functioned with ships, they are only representing themselves as a symbolization of real ones. And it's claimed by the images and rhetoric that Rumeli seaside villa carries up today the features of traditional Ottoman architecture, describing this structure as a work of art. It makes you feel like an old Istanbuler and aristocrat living in a special seaside villa and sailing in Bosphorus. The second rhetoric accompanying the image says that you can be a very special person by the help of where you living like on the image.